Hi, my name's Elitia Hart. I'm a metal art instructor based in Alberta, Calgary in Canada. I want to tell you a little bit about metal embossing and my love for this wonderful craft medium. I was lucky enough to be introduced to metal embossing about 14 years ago when I lived in Hout Bay in South Africa by a very talented friend. My love for this medium comes from the fact that you don't need expensive tools or work surfaces or processes to do this craft, and also the versatility of it. You can apply it to crafts that you already do, like scrapbooking. You can adhere it to canvases. It just has such an amazing versatility. So with this video, I'd like to introduce you to the different tools that we use, a little bit about the process and surfaces that we use, and I hope that I'm able to make a few more of these instructional videos and that you'll join me when I post them. So you can also find me on my website on pewterart.ca, as well as on Facebook, Elitia Hart Metal Art. I post a lot of the projects that I do and just always enjoy the teaching process. So hope to see you there. Thank you. Okay, so we do need to talk a little bit about the different surfaces that we use. You do need a hard, smooth surface. The metal is so soft that it often picks up any texture that might be on your hard surface. So always make sure that your hard surface is smooth, doesn't have any grit or anything on that. You can use acrylic matte, or in this case, like I have here, is just an MDF or a masonite board. You also need a thin mat, which is in this case just a compressed thin foam. You also need a thicker foam for deeper embossing. And what I usually like to use is also a paper pad. And the paper pad basically consists of about five recycled 8x11 sheets of paper. And this paper pad sort of goes in between your hard surface and your thin mat. It's a little bit like Goldilocks and the Bears. Just finding the right one as you learn to work in metal embossing, how much pressure you need to apply. Somebody that has a very light touch would find it hard to actually get to make a mark on the hard surface. So the paper pad is a good substitute for that until you find your happy place in terms of how much pressure you apply onto the metal. Okay, so we have talked about our surfaces. We'll talk a little bit about basic tools. And usually what I remind people is that if it makes a mark, it is a tool. And we're very lucky nowadays that we have a lot of great hand tools out there. And they all make great marks. And, you know, I always say a girl can never have enough tools. But really, you just need basic hand tools for metal embossing. It's always nice to have more tools. But certainly we can get away with very little. I've done whole projects just with a pencil, so really no excuse in terms of the tools. We don't need to break the bank. So what we have here is we have a little Teflon tip tool on one side. It has a little, like I said, Teflon tip on one side, which is almost just like plastic. And then it has a little steel or sharp little stylus on the other side. We also have a ball tool which on the other side has a cup part, and I'll show you shortly how we use that. In this basic little kit we have a texture wheel which is great for putting textures onto the metal or make lines that are raised. We also have a little brass brush. And then we have a little wheel that has a very fine serrated edge to it. And this is nice for making straight lines and creating texture onto the metal as well. I want to just talk briefly about the metal that we use. So when I started in metal embossing about 14 years ago, I started off using pewter sheet. Obviously, this was in South Africa, and I was very lucky to be introduced to metal embossing by a very talented friend in Hout Bay, South Africa. And we started off using, she introduced us to pewter sheet. And unfortunately, the pewter sheet that I still work with and that is readily available to me does contain a small percentage of lead. So I always just remind people not to lick or chew it. Always just use good craft practices. Wash your hands before you eat or drink. And then I always seal my projects with a clear lacquer spray. Especially if it's something that's going to be handled a lot, like switchblade covers, or but we always only use the pewter sheet in for decorative purposes, so in artworks and things like that, never with food. Just a little bit of a reminder about that. It is tin coated. The one thing that I love about the pewter, that it does work like butter. So we always refer to the pewter almost like the cashmere of metal. And just has a beautiful, rich luster to you to it when you've applied patina that you cannot really replicate all that well with the aluminums. And the aluminums that we use are about 38 to 40 gauge. The pewter sheet is about 36 gauge. So the bigger the gauge, the thinner the metal. And then it becomes not a sheet of metal, it actually becomes more of a foil. So a little bit about the aluminum. You can find the aluminum just clear and shiny like that, or you can find the aluminum with a color coating on the front. Obviously, this will be the front of the metal and this will be the back, unless you choose to use the shiny side of it as your front. In order to almost replicate a little bit the pewter look to it, although it does have a little bit more of a tinny look to it. So we work a little bit differently with these metals in order to add patinas and things like that, but the basic metal embossing process is the same. So let's talk a little bit about the process. When we do metal embossing, there's a few different lines that that we work with. So when I'm using my little scratchy tool or my steel stylus here, we usually work on the hard surface on the front of the pewter. Another little tip I just wanted to remind you of is when you purchase pewter and you roll it off the roll, the inside of the roll is usually the back of your pewter. It's really hard to discern what is the front and what is the back once you've rolled it off your roll, and what once you've cut it, you know, it's all sort of starts to blend and it's a little bit difficult to see. So when you start off and you're not exactly sure what the front or the back of your metal is, just mark it with the B, and when I refer to the back, the B is right there to tell us what it is. So the first little line that we do in metal embossing is basically an engraving or a scratching or whatever you want to call it. And we use our little scratchy tool or our steel stylus on the hard surface that we have. If you use this particular little tool on a softer surface, maybe like the paper pad or the thin foam mat, it's really easy to break through the metal because it is quite sharp. The great thing about this little stylus is that you can do some really fine designs with it. And if you're into tangling on paper, if you sort of transfer that kind of tangling designs onto the metal, I just call it metangle. And this little scratchy tool offers you the opportunity to really transfer those doodles and tangles onto the surface of the metal. So what we have here is just a scratching or a debossing, meaning that the lines go into the metal. Our little Teflon tip tool that we have on the other side is great for also working on the hard surface, and you'll see that it actually creates a little bit of a thicker line as opposed to the nice thin little marks that we could make with our stylus. And again, we're doing a little bit of a debossing, working on the paper pad, on the front of the metal, and just making a recessed line into the metal. And once we put our patina or our inks on, these lines allow you to, the ink grabs onto it in the recesses, and that gives you a little bit of dimension as well. The second very exciting thing, line that we do in metal embossing is when we work from the back of the metal on the soft cloth, and we use our little Teflon tip tool and make a nice smooth line from the back. You apply medium pressure. Some people are very light-handed, and if you're very light-handed, you're probably not going to get the greatest result in the front. So you want to apply enough pressure. Your pewter is on the back, and you're on the soft foam mat, so that when you turn it around, you have a definite raised line on the front. And we always put our metal front side up on the hard surface, and we refine on both sides of our raised line. And that sort of neatens our little design up, you know, grounds your little design and just makes it a little bit crisper, and definitely neatens up your work. I've often seen embossing from the back, and I'll just do a quick little word here for you from the back, and you can see that of course lettering needs to be done in mirror image. Again, with my Teflon tip tool, just on the back of the metal on the soft cloth, and then when you turn it around, you've got it raised on the front. And you'll see that I'm always rubbing with my finger over my designs, and what I'm trying to do is just flattening the background. And this is where your paper stump comes in very handy. Just flattening the background around your little raised designs already neatens up your work. And it's really important throughout any metal embossing that you do is to always flatten your background. And when you do that, your little raised designs that you've worked so hard to get onto the metal just pops up a little bit more. Especially with lettering, we need to refine on both sides of the raised line. Again, I'm on my hard surface, on the front of my pewter, and I refine on both sides of the raised line. And that's what gives you really crisp lines and design, and especially if you've done lettering, really an important part of metal embossing. The next tool that's one of my favorite design tools in one of the beginner sets that we have is our little ball and cup tool. And working with the ball tool, it's an embossing. So embossing means that your line ends up raised from the front of the surface of the metal. So embossing we do from the back. On the soft cloth, you press your ball tool down, give it a little swizzle, turn it around, and now we need to refine. And when we refine, we're on the hard surface, turn it around, take the cup part of this double-sided tool, put it over the ball and press down. And that's what gives you your instant little refining without you having to take your stylus and refine around it. Always flatten your background in between your raised designs, and again, that neatens up your little design. Another thing that we can use our cup part of the tool is just the cup part of the tool, and in this case I'm using my paper pad because it gives a little but it doesn't give too much, and I'm just pressing the cup part into the surface of the metal, and that gives me these beautiful little circles. And again, if you're into tangling, I just call it metangling, this gives you a nice repetitive round little circle, very nice and crisp, and you would never think that that was done by hand, right? So that's another little way to use your ball and cup tool. The other great tools in metal embossing is our texture wheels. And the way I use my texture wheels, if I'm going to use it on the front of my pewter, is I'm just on my paper pad, again, because it gives a little, but it doesn't give too much stretch to the metal, and you just scoot it along. So around the edges here, just scoot, 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 and as you scoot, you transfer a lot of the texture of your wheel onto the metal here. Another way that we can use our texture wheel is if we were to use it as an embossing, so from the back on the soft cloth, and we just scoot along, and when we look at the front, the line is raised on the front, and what do with a raised line? We're on the hard surface and we refine on both sides of the raised line. So another wonderful technique in metal embossing. So when we're looking at all of these lines that we've done, these are basically low relief lines, which means that the line is not high relief. When we're talking about high relief, it's when we've embossed the metal to such an extent that we need to raise it that we need to fill it in order for it to hold its form. So if you do high relief and you don't put a filler in it, it can collapse. So I'll do a quick little demo for you on high relief, and there's a few ways to do this. So we'll do a little classic high relief, working from the back on the soft cloth. We start off by doing a low relief line, refine on the hard surface, and now when I look at my little heart, I want to raise this. So I'm going to go back on my soft cloth, use my paper stump, and then just stretch the metal on the inside of my lines, and when I turn it around, put it on the hard surface, flatten the background, and boom, you have a little high relief design. The other classic way of doing high relief is when you start on the front, and this will eliminate this extra line of low relief that you have around your little heart there. So you start on the front, on the soft surface with my little Teflon tip tool, and I draw my little design. I turn it around, I'm still on the soft mat, and just on the inside of the original line, I line again. So when I turn it around and I put it on my hard surface, I flatten the background, and you can see how my little design is already starting to pop. Now I can put it back on my soft surface and use my paper stump and gently, gently just allow the metal to stretch gradually. Turn it around, put it on the hard surface, and again flatten around the edges here. And any successful high relief, you need to allow the metal to stretch gradually. So working from the back on the soft surface, and then you need to counteract that on the hard surface and flatten the background. And this pewter is so amazing. It can stretch quite extensively. So at some stage, you need to just decide to stop. To talk a little bit about fillers, I usually use just melted beeswax and then fill my little design from the back with the melted beeswax. The advantage to that is that it's pretty much ready for me to work with again after about a minute once I've allowed the wax to cool off. So it's just melted beeswax in a little pot, never leave it alone, and then just fill it up with a little glass dropper, and I can continue to work with it pretty much right away. Other alternatives is embossed metal backing paste that you can use. This is a little paste and it has a nice little applicator. You can just pour your backing paste in there. It does take at least 2 to 4 hours to harden completely before you can work with this again. And the same for something called DAP, or it's a little bit like a spackle. You can push that in there with an old credit card and just wipe it away. Again, you need to take the time and allow it to dry. Okay, so that's as far as filling goes. Then let's talk a little bit about patina. And when we're working with pewter, There's a few ways that we can add a little bit of dimension to and color to our projects. I like to use as a quick and easy non-toxic sort of process with the metal embossing. I use a water-based permanent marker. You can also use black acrylic paint and just like Mr. Miyagi, you wax on and then you wax off. So you pretty much just put the ink on. And this is not a Sharpie. Again, this is a water-based permanent marker. It allows a little bit of window for you to remove the ink, whereas a Sharpie, once that ink is down, it's down. So, and then I usually just wipe in one direction, and you can see how the ink goes into the little nooks and crannies there, and that gives you a little bit of dimension. You can now go with your permanent markers and add some color on top of the black. You can use some alcohol inks and things like that to add some color, and you can also use glass paint to add color to that. The other process in metal embossing, is particularly in pewter, is we use a pewter blackener that simulates the oxidization process pretty much instantly that usually happens in nature over many, many, many years. It contains hydrochloric acid and selenious acid and reacts immediately with the metal, turning it sort of black, and then we polish it up to a shine again. So you can see the difference between the pewter that has been patinaed and the one that hasn't, because there's this beautiful aged look to this. It has an awesome patina and has some beautiful highs and lows in the metal. So the process is a little bit more involved. You do need to use gloves. Obviously the process is very corrosive, so once you use the pewter blackener, keep all your metal tools away from them, and then always seal your project once you've used pewter patina, because this project will oxidize again really quickly. So once you've sealed it, and I usually just use a clear spray lacquer, and it'll stay nice and shiny, and you don't have to buff it up to a shine again. And certainly if you're doing it in things like journal covers like this, definitely, absolutely, no question about it. If you've used the pewter blackener on there, you do need to seal this. And again, not just for the fact that it has a little bit of lead in it, but also the fact that you've started the oxidization process. And as the patina reacts with your fingers or oils or the humidity in the air, it'll turn black again unless you seal it. Just a quick little look at the colored aluminums. And we spoke briefly about that. Of course, I mentioned to you that my first love is definitely pewter. This is black aluminum. So the top coating of the aluminum was black. And then we worked from the back and then sanded the raised lines. And then that gives you that the shiny part of the aluminum coming through. This is the color-coated aluminum. It's called Peacock. The process to work with the metal in terms of metal embossing is exactly the same as with the pewter sheet. So if we work from the back on the soft cloth, turn it around on the hard surface. Sorry, I'm always have my finger on hand, so I do tend to use that more than I use my paper stump. Flatten the background, use your Teflon tip tool and refine on both sides of the raised line. And we can add some details to this. And in this case, I'm using my Teflon tip tool, just doing a little debossing on the front here. And in this case, the patina process, in inverted commas, is a little bit different. So we use a sanding block and we sand our top coating off the raised lines. And you can see you've got some beautiful colors in the recessed areas and the raised areas, when we use our sanding block, we lift the color off the raised areas, giving you a little bit of dimension. The other thing that we have in our starter toolkit is our brass brush. And the brass brush is very effective on the colored aluminum. I'm not too fond of using the brass brush on the pewter because, of course, it dulls it. Where you do use the brass brush on the pewter is when you want your background to be really, really dark. The patina really grabs onto areas where you've worked with the brass brush. But I mostly use the brass brush in the when I work with the colored aluminums, because you can sort of focus on certain areas where you want to remove color a little bit better than you can with the sanding block. The sanding block is a little bit more indiscriminate where it removes color, but with the brass brush, you can pretty much dedicatedly use some color. Okay, so I hope that's given you a little bit of insight into the processes, tools, and surfaces for metal embossing. I hope to do a few more of these little videos and hope that you'll tune in to look at that.